लाइव नाउ।
नमस्ते, गुड मॉर्निंग वन एंड ऑल। आई भावना कश्यप वेलकम यू ऑल टू द वेबिनार विकसना एनईपी 2020 विजन टू एक्शन ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ दिशा भारत। दिशा भारत इज अ नॉन प्रॉफिट सोशल इनिशिएटिव स्टार्टेड इन द ईयर 2005। दिशा भारत प्रोवाइड्स होलिस्टिक एजुकेशन, वैल्यू बेस्ड एजुकेशन टू स्टूडेंट्स, टीचर्स एंड पेरेंट्स अक्रॉस स्कूल्स एंड कॉलेजेस। और दिशा भारत प्रोवाइड्स दिस एजुकेशन ऑन द थीम नो योर सेल्फ, नो योर कंट्री एंड नो योर कल्चर। एक्टिविटी बेस्ड प्रोग्राम्स आर डिवाइस्ड टू इनकल्केट वैल्यूज टू द पार्टिसिपेंट्स। 2020 हैज बीन अ माइलस्टोन ईयर फॉर ऑल एजुकेटर्स फॉर मोर रीजन देन वन। इन द वेक ऑफ कोरोना द एजुकेशन सिस्टम केम टू अ ग्राइंडिंग हॉल्ट, बट आवर एजुकेशन इंस्टीट्यूशंस शोड अप्लॉडेबल ग्रिट and adapted quickly to online teaching and learning. However, this year 2020 is also widely remembered for the National Education 20 or NEP20, the government of India. This came after a long gap of 34 years. This policy caters to the 21st century 21st century learners. Noteworthy is that the policy envisions transforming the system by transforming the youth of our great nation. The policy beautifully balances the needs of the current generation, the needs of the future, and also the rich culture, knowledge, and value system that Bharat is blessed with. It is my absolute privilege to welcome all the speakers of today, Dr. Anil Sahasrabuddhe, Dr. M.K. Sridhar, and Dr. C.N. Ashwath Narayan, and Srimati Rekha Ramachandran to this webinar. This webinar wouldn't be possible without all of you, the esteemed participants, vice chancellors, heads of institutions, senior faculty, and all those interested in making difference to the world of education. Representations from all areas of Bharat are on one forum. This makes us very humble and also reminds us of the responsibility in front of us. Without much further ado, let's move on to the first session of Vikasana NEP 2020 Vision to Action. To invite the speaker, I would like to invite Dr. Sushma Bhavle, an accomplished teacher and enthusiastic learner, the retired principal of Maharani Lakshmi Ammani College for Women, Bangalore, has been a source of inspiration in Disha since its inception. She has helped Disha grow from strength to strength. Welcome, Sushma ma'am, and over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. A very good morning to all participants of Vikasana 2020. I deem it my privilege to introduce Professor Anil Sahasrabuddhe, the distinguished speaker for the first technical session, NEP 2020, Teachers as Champions of Change. Professor Sahasrabuddhe has had an illustrious career, graduated from BVB College of Engineering and Technology, Hubli, with a gold medal, thereafter obtained a master's and doctorate from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He is a recipient of a number of awards and fellowships. To name a few, gold medals in all his academic endeavors, UGC Fellowship Award, Maha Entrepreneur Award, Edupreneur Award. He has held several important academic, research, and administrative positions in Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, Tata Consulting Engineers, Northeastern Regional Institute of Science and Technology, Itanagar, and IIT Guwahati. Currently, he is the chairman of AICTE and the chairman of Board of Governors, NIT Arunachal Pradesh. He is chairman of Basic Scientific Research, Empowered Committee of UGC and Swayam Board, a government initiative on education. Professor Anil Sahasrabuddhe has played an important role in the development of the NEP 2020, having been part of its negotiations and in its evolution to its current form. In his words, NEP will pave the way for the requisite changes that were necessary for the last few decades and usher in meeting the expectations of the millennial learners. I request Professor Anil Sahasrabuddhe to kindly take over. Thank you.
Namaskara.
I'm indeed pleased to be amongst all of you, Madam Sushma Bhavle ji, Bhavna Kashyap ji, Rajesh ji of Disha Bharat, who have at the right time organized this particular webinar, very important at this occasion, because National New Education Policy, which was announced by the Government of India on the 29th of July, our friend Dr. M.K. Sridhar, who was also part of the committee which pronounced this policy through Dr. Kasturi Rangan committee, is also with us. In fact, he was to speak before me, but I requested for a change because there is a meeting at 11:30. So I wanted to come in first, and I'm thankful to Dr. Sridhar for making way for me to speak first, although the policy initiatives have to be set first and then the role of teachers will come. But anyway, that is a change which has happened. Dr. Ashwath Narayanan, who is the Deputy Chief Minister, also Education Minister of Karnataka, who is speaking on role of education institutions. Dr. Rekha Ramchandran, who will talk about the role of Disha Bharat itself. I think it's a very exciting time. I will come back to the topic, which is of very great significance, but most importantly, the National Education Policy has been completely reform-driven. Although basics of education will not change, they are constant. As rightly pointed out by Swami Vivekananda long ago, that education is nothing but manifestation of perfection already in man. So I think that is the role of the education, which has been there from time immemorial, right from Gurukula system in the ancient times in India to the universities of Takshila and Nalanda and Vikramshila and many others. You know, there were 8 universities from 6th century BC to about 12th century AD. Even our education system was thriving till 17th, 18th century. It's only after we should all understand that Macaulay came in and then tried to destroy the whole system, created clerk producing system, then the education got spoiled in India. But otherwise, if someone has to talk about education system in the whole world, it is the Indian education system. Even looking at the present day world of excellent institutions in the world, whether it is Oxford, Cambridge, MIT, Stanford, or any other universities in most of the developed countries, so-called developed countries today, that is USA, Canada, UK, Australia, Singapore, Japan, all of these institutions follow the same route which we followed at the time of Nalanda Takshila. So if they are trying to teach us something, it's wrong actually. It is our system which they have followed. For example, Guru Shishya Parampara, that the role of teachers in the education system, we have corrupted ourselves. If you look at our education institutions today, in the institutions, the teacher hardly knows the names of the students of his class, maybe 5-10 students out of 60 or 70. Those who create disturbance in the class by sitting in the back benches and sending aeroplanes, or those in the front bench who answer to the questions asked by the faculty member. Other 50-odd% of the students are absolutely not known to the faculty members. There is not even eye contact. From there, we have to move ahead. Actually, the Guru Shishya Parampara, which we talk about, the role of teachers in the ancient times was to identify the talent that is there in every student. Each student is made of a different mold. They are not same. Someone may be very good in archery. Someone may be good in Gada Yuddha. Someone else is good in the academics, someone good in shlokas, someone in writing skills, someone in doing hands-on work. I think this identification of the talent that is inherent in each individual, the interest that an individual has to be understood by the teacher and try to invoke that and then try to support it, try to take the best one that is there inside the student out. That was the role of the teacher, and that was happening in this country, and suddenly it was stopped. Now, when I refer to those universities across the globe, like Oxford, Cambridge, or Stanford, or MIT, or Berkeley, or Princeton, there the relationship between the teachers and the students is exactly the same way as it existed in the past in India. That means we don't have to worry about not depending on the West, but relook at our own models. And that is what this policy also talks about, Indian knowledge systems. You know, how we were trying to do our own system of education is to be relooked at. Now, we will come back to some of the issues which have been happening currently and what needs to be changed. For example, there are different types of teaching learning systems that we are aware of today. That is classroom teaching, where class is held, teacher comes, delivers a lecture, 50 minutes, 60 minutes. There are tutorials where problem solving happens in a smaller group. There are laboratory classes where students go for a batch of 20 or 25 instead of 60 students. Then there are different types of experiential learning systems. You go to outside world, you go to the field, you go to industry for internship. I think all of this, what happens today in terms of teaching learning processes, is what is known to the Western world today, and that has again come back to us in the form of either called blended learning, the online education plus face-to-face mode of learning, experiential learning, project-based learning. These are the terminologies which have all come in the recent times from abroad. But if you look at our own system, there were 51 different styles of teaching learning processes. And therefore this policy, while many times people say that it is learner-centric or student-centric, it is actually learning-centric. So everyone has to learn together, a lifelong learning system. And that is what was happening in the ancient times. That is, a teacher and student used to learn together. It's not that only the teacher was teaching to the students, but teacher was certainly teaching to the students. At the same time, whatever student knew, he was exploring. So exploration, self-exploration was the methodology which was used. And through this methodology of self-exploration, teacher also used to learn from students then and even today. And that is where the change is required in our education system. So when we talk about students coming into the system from primary school to high school to finally the higher education system, we must deal with all variety of education system as a continuum. And although for the convenience of different types of educational institutions, we may divide that into different forms. And in the new policy, when we talk about primary education being of 15 years rather than 12 years, starting from the age of 3 at 5+3+3+4 system, and the first 5 years being formative years, where a lot of foundational things are going to be talked about, where skills of the nature of listening, reading, and also speaking skills are developed in the form of games, in terms of playing with toys, experimenting, learning by doing, and all of that which is being talked about in the foundational years without stress. I think that is where the mind gets liberated and innovation starts developing in the mind. The left and right brain start functioning together, and the holistic approach of education begins from the school education in the mother tongue. And if this is continued beyond the sixth standard of present today, that means after the 5+3, after that much is covered, I'm sure a lot of skill sets are to be taught. The vocational education is important. Variety of vocations. It may be carpentry, it may be welding, it may be electronics technician, it may be gardening, it may be agriculture, it may be even history, it may be geography. Different types of skills, travel, tourism. I think any candidate, anyone who is interested in whatever domain must be able to explore those skill sets, may be supported. And then when he goes on, and then when he completes that present 12th standard or the new 5+3+3+4, that means 15 years of education, a child comes fully prepared, geared up for taking up higher education in the 4-year degree program. And in the 4-year degree program also, when there are multiple entry exit points which are allowed, banking of credits is allowed, I'm sure the role of teacher becomes more and more important. And the teacher's role as an empowerer, as a champion for change, begins from there. You know, teacher from primary school, when he or she will start narrating stories which are value-based, ethics, morals are embedded, like Panchatantra stories, giving them some toys and games through which they learn and self-explore. You know, self-exploration starts from the age of 3 to 5, 6, learn different languages, not necessarily only mother tongue, but along with that, couple of other languages. All of this is going to be empowering for the student through the teacher. And that's why the role of teacher is very, very important. So whether it is curriculum, framing of the curriculum, which is useful to the child, to the student, to the society, to the industry, to the entire globe, world, whether it is in terms of environment, whether it is in terms of holistic outlook towards the society, towards development itself, the way the development is defined, taking care of the environment itself, all of this has to be embedded in the curriculum. We all talk about our rights, but how our responsibilities and duties are equally important. How do we teach that to the students? So I think the curriculum has to be designed in a manner that we will create sensitive citizens to all variety of diversity that exists in our country and in fact in the entire globe. And the diversity exists in form of human beings, in terms of animal world, in terms of plant world, in terms of different nations, different geographies, different languages, different cultures, different dresses, different food habits. I think, how do we respect this? And unless the curriculum engages a student in terms of all of this, which we have started experimenting as AICT's role model program for 3 weeks of student induction program, where students after their 12th standard, when they come into the higher education system, first 3 weeks, we are designing it in a manner that there are no classes, but there are intense activities starting from early morning at 5:30, 6 o'clock till late night, 10 o'clock, starting from playing games, going to the playground, exercise, yoga, meditation, coming back, lots of discussions in different subjects, countered by different people. There will be experts who will be dealing with some of the subjects. They will lead with the subject, but then students will discuss amongst themselves, try to investigate their own inner self, actually. That is very important. And also, whether it is Ayurveda, whether it is healthcare, whether it is in terms of society as an entity, what is ailing in our society, what needs to be done, all of that in the form of collaborative work that we will engage in, even looking around geographically important places, historically important places, thereby the width also increases. At the same time, in certain domains, depth can increase. So different types of art forms, whether it is music, dance, painting, sculpting, all of these are also being provided in those 3 weeks as one of the sort of small elective, you know, mini elective. It may be 2 hours per day a student goes through, say, classical dance or a classical music or painting, drama. All of this will engage students in the institution. They start making this institute as their own. That means ownership gets developed. And in all of this program, when a teacher is associated with every 20 students, naturally that teacher will automatically become a guide, mentor, philosopher for that particular set of students. And then any difficulty which arises in that institution in the next 3-4 years, students will not complain, will not create strikes, dharnas, breaking of glasses of the windows of the college or the hostel or doors, but they will try to solve the problems. They will become companion of the engagement of the institution, teacher, administration. And that is what this program is talking about. And therefore, the role of teacher, which we have envisaged in those 3 week student induction program through a course called Universal Human Values. I think that is very, very significant. And we need to incorporate this in, not in technical education, which we have already done for the last 3 years, is required in every facet of education, right from primary education, secondary education, to arts, law, medicine, everywhere. And that is where future citizens of the country are going to be created, who are useful to the society, who are useful to the nation, who are useful to the world at large. And therefore, the role of teachers, again, coming back, is in the form of starting with the curriculum design. The design of the curriculum should be such that it is engaging, it is joyful, it is in terms of learning something new every day. I think when we do that, the rule of attendance of 75% being mandatory by the university before he is allowed to write examination will vanish, because students will come to the college to learn something every day new. And that is the role of teacher. First, as I said, curriculum, and how we deliver that curriculum. It is not one-way traffic. In every class, maybe a few minutes a teacher may speak and subsequently ask students certain questions, thereby create enthusiasm, interest in the subject on one side, and then get ideas which are there in the minds of the students out, and deliberation, discussion amongst the students. And then motivating them, and also in the form of guiding them in the process. I think that is the way forward which has to happen in even a classroom. The classroom has to be almost like a tutorial room, where there is an intense discussion, deliberation, and the churning takes place. And the basis of churning, you will get Amruta out of that, and which that nectar, each student will be able to use it lifelong. I think that is the spirit with which the classes have to be handled. Then why not take the students to the outside? Not only in the class, actually students learn more outside the classroom than inside the classroom. And therefore, experiential learning, which is so important. In the times of Gurukula system, the students were asked to go and collect firewood for burning and create food or cooking purposes, or get or fetch water from the river or well. And thereby they used to learn the entire, not only work is also important, but at the same time, along with the work, what is the scientific basis behind that? How a pot of water has to be brought from about a kilometer or two without spilling that water? How you have to balance yourself? I think several learnings used to happen. I think today's world also, why can't we, right from our school children, take them to the garden nearby, take them to the playground, take them to the railway station, take them to the bus stand, take them on the road, and try to show them how different people are behaving, how people with physical challenges are still able to do something despite all odds, whereas with all elements being in place, we are not able to do. So make aware that the five senses which the God has given, to use them, whether it is in terms of eyes to visualize things which are happening around, or ears to listen to many things, or even the skin, the tongue, the smell, all of that must be made use of effectively, so that a learning process begins through what we call as critical thinking. And that is very important. So take to an agriculture field and let them look at the farmer, the way he is working, the hard work, toiling during rains, during summer heat, and then they will realize the hard work always is going to be respected by the students when they realize themselves. And that's why I take them to the slums, take them to the villages, take them to different types of scenarios and engage them. I think that is what a teacher has to do. And if the teacher is completely engaged and he is passionate about it, he is sincere about it, he is honest, then automatically these characteristics are imbibed by students. Although we see that amongst the 100 odd teachers in the college or a school, even if about 5 to 10% of the teachers behave the way I have been narrating in terms of engaging with students, talking to them in a friendly manner, taking them to the outside world, showing them industry, showing them the garden, the agriculture field, and then discuss about those issues. Take them to the forest, different types of animals, birds. The way the students will start learning and start respecting that teacher is phenomenal. Maybe he's strict or she is a strict teacher in terms of evaluating the examination papers. The person may be very, very strict. Despite that, the students will respect that teacher in the long term. Maybe at a particular time when a small punishment is given by the teacher, they may feel bad about it. At that particular small fragment of a minute or a second or whatever, but subsequently they will realize that this was all meant for the good of mine. And that is where they start respecting. And we have umpteen examples, such strict teachers, but still friendly. I think that balance is very, very important, because teachers as a champion of change need to imbibe several qualities. And these qualities start from primary school to the highest education, including PhD. So that is why I was telling, in the foreign universities, they have changed and taken our system. You look at any of the PhD supervisors, guides in the Western universities, they're absolutely friendly with the students, and a student can discuss any topic. In our institutions today, there is a taboo. A teacher is supposed to be something at a highest pedestal, that's fine. Respect is different, and friendliness is a different angle, and that is what is needed to be created. A student should feel absolutely comfortable in asking a very difficult or very easy or very silly question as well. I think no student should be deprived of asking questions. If a teacher does not know the answer, maybe you come back little later, one day later, 2 days later, after looking into the books, internet, or asking your own teacher friends that I don't know this, will you please explain to me, and I want to tell this to my students in the classroom. I think if this is done, students' respect will increase. And that's why whenever we say the teachers are champions of change, we all know all revolutions that happened all around the world happened during youthful times. No old people can create revolutions. It's only the young generation, students at the age of 15, 16, 20, 25, they are the ones who are the agents of change. But who can really guide them? Who can transform them? Who will give them the right path? And that is the role of teacher. And therefore, teacher as a champion has a multifaceted role, not just as a teacher in a classroom to teach something which is known to him. That anyway, today internet is there. There are YouTube, there are video lectures, there are audio lectures. All of this is available in the form of information. So information today is bound so much that, you know, gigabits and terabits of information is available at the doorsteps of students on his mobile phone, on his laptop, on his computer. And therefore, that is not what is required today from the teacher. Teacher is required to convert this information into knowledge, how it is useful, how it is applicable, where it is applicable, why it is applicable, how it has to be made applicable to the society at large and good for the nation, good for the society, good for the environment. And then this transformation of information into knowledge is very important. But from knowledge to wisdom is a higher level. And that is what teacher has to again engage. And that's where teachers or heads of the institutions have a role to empower teachers in order to convert knowledge into wisdom and wisdom into application, which is useful to society. Create those products, processes, which will help the society in terms of removing drudgery of the people who are working hard. You know, their life should be made comfortable. Technology enables that. People who are, whom we call today as Divyangas, that is physically challenged, how can we help a blind person to learn? How can we help a person to climb stairs who does not have legs? How can we help a person who does not have ears or the voice? How can you empower him through the language of sign? I think all of this, every faculty and student have to know it. Only then we get sensitized to the difficulties that they are facing. Similarly, how about people from very remote areas, the mountainous areas, the tribal areas, the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, who have been deprived for several now decades and prior to independence, they were all left out of the education sector. How do we bring them back into the mainstream? How do we increase the gross enrollment ratio from 27 to 50%? How do we have use of technology in terms of our online education, which has already started happening during the pandemic? How do we do all of that? I think this is what is required to be done by the teachers. And therefore, the role of teachers is very, very significant. Now, I'll come to the last part, which I wanted to describe. And that is about our role as teachers has been defined in 8 modules, which AICT had a committee headed by a very renowned professor. And then several professors came out, and then knitters have created that particular 8 module program, starting from passion for teaching itself, that as a teacher, as a role that you have to play. And then secondly, how do you design curriculum? How do you engage with students? How do you establish communication? How do you create the question papers which will instigate students to start learning on their own? Lifelong learning is also brought into that. How values, ethics, morals are brought into the curriculum, and how by the role model teacher, it will be infectious amongst the students. I think this is what is to be taught. And we have this 8 module program, which is made mandatory for certifying. After that, only a teacher will get regularized or becomes permanent. So I think this is to be expanded to all other forms of education. If you are able to do all of this, I'm sure Disha Bharat, which is doing a wonderful job, and I'm thankful to Disha Bharat for engaging into this new national education policy, the role of teachers, role of educational institutions, role of the leadership, the heads of the institutions, how we can all do all of this is very, very significant. And in the name itself, these two words, Disha and Bharat, you know, we want to create that Bharat, young India, empowered India, And Disha is the direction which is being given by this Disha. I'm thankful to you for this. And if there are any questions based on what I have said, and many other ideas are there in the mind, but the time is limited. I have to go to another program. Today is the Constitution Day. We have to take oath. Honorable President is giving oath of Constitution that not only our rights, but duties and responsibilities are important. Our fellow citizens, respecting them is important. Respecting everyone else is important. I think that is another program. And then there is a ministries program. So I will take leave after about next few minutes. But meanwhile, if there are any questions on the talk which I have given, I'm ready to answer those queries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your enlightening talk. It was indeed our privilege to listen to you. Sir, with your permission, I have two questions from the audience here. The first one is, teachers, as you said, have a great role in the developing of the students. But for that, the teachers have to undergo a personal transformation themselves. And the NEP stresses on two things, a research orientation and a digital literacy. What is your message for young teachers on this regard, sir?
Bhavna ji, I have already said about 8-module teacher training program, which we have envisaged, which takes care of all these issues which are there. One is the digital education. Teacher has to be, first of all, lifelong learner himself or herself. Only then you can tell that to students. And I remember here stories that are there in almost all parts of the country with different names. From Marathi, I know about Sant Ramadas. Then one day a lady went there and said that my son eats a lot of jaggery. That time there was no sugar. Please tell him not to eat jaggery. He said, come tomorrow. And he went on postponing it. And after about a couple of months, one fine day, Ramdas Swamiji told the child, don't eat jaggery. Then a lady asked, this you could have said on the first day, why did you take 2 months? He said, I myself was eating jaggery. How can I tell the child that don't eat jaggery? So the teacher has to first follow what he wants to preach to his students. And that's why when we talk about values, ethics, morals, I think whether I myself follow that has to be introspected by every teacher. And this is what is self-reflection. I think our emphasis all along in the Universal Human Values Program for faculty members training workshop is on not forcing anyone to accept anything. Please explore yourself, convince yourself, and then do it. And if you do it to teachers, naturally teachers in turn will take it to the classes.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir, for the answer. I'm sure our teachers will take your message. With your permission, one other question, sir.
Yeah, a couple of more questions, doesn't matter.
Okay. Role, again, the 21st century teachers, it's a very crucial role. In your view, how should the management support these teachers and how should the teachers interact with the management? In a way, it's going to be healthy and it is going to finally benefit the learners. As you said, the NEP is all about learning. So at every stage, how can we have a healthy learning?
This is a very important question for the management. See, very interestingly, everyone today talks about autonomy. I didn't touch upon the subject of autonomy in my talk, but this policy, as well as earlier policies, all had talked about autonomy to the institutions. So from the regulators, I represent a regulatory body, AICT, in technical education. Similarly, UGC is there for university. So there are lots of rules, regulations, and they are all sometimes throttled. And therefore, one wants to break away from that. And therefore, managements keep asking for autonomy. Well said, and it has to be given. Everyone has to be autonomous, free to have their own curriculum, their own examination, their own evaluation systems. But the same administration of the institution, that means managements, whether it is government, board of governors, or it may be a private institution, trust, or society, they should in turn also give autonomy to their respective teachers. So on one side, you want to drive autonomy, enjoy autonomy, but when it is to give to the next level lower, you are always strict. Same is the case with the teachers. Teachers want autonomy from the heads of the institutions or the heads of the departments, But when it comes to the autonomy of the students to choose the subject or to do in a particular manner, then we always put the restrictions. I think autonomy is a two-way game, actually. So it is both from the top and at the bottom. So both have to be looked at. At the same time, autonomy and freedom does not mean licentiousness. And therefore, there must be Lakshman Rekhas, boundaries drawn by each individual. What I have autonomy, but I will go only to this extent, not beyond that. I think that self-introspection, self-reflection will allow you to do that. And if you do that, I'm sure managements also will realize that if the college has to be a better college or a good college, an excellent college, they must provide support to the individuals. That means whether it is staff members, faculty members, and students. Only then everyone will thrive. And in the thriving of all the citizens of that institution, like our nation's citizenship, when we say Atmanirbhar Bharat by the Prime Minister, every individual has to be Atmanirbhar. Then only nation will become Atmanirbhar. Same way, every individual, when he or she is empowered, then naturally institution will grow. So this message, all managements of the institutions who are listening, they must come forward and support in terms of whether it is research, in terms of innovation. If you do that, institution will also succeed, prosper, and also collaboration with other institutions, taking best practices from other institutions, imbibing those values. I think these are very important. And don't say that institute is doing like that. I will not do it. You know, please learn from their mistakes also. Sometimes some institution has done mistake. Don't repeat that mistake. Go ahead with good practices.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your message. We understand you had given us time till 11:10 and we are almost there. So if you want, I think we really thank you very
much. I was seeing a question here, which is very relevant. Many times this question is being asked. So I would like to answer this to Santosh Joshi. What would be the status of polytechnic in new education policy? Because in new education policy, nowhere polytechnic education per se is explicitly mentioned. And that's why probably this doubt has arisen. There are two facets. If you look at technical education, because this is in particular for technical education, the ITIs, which create technicians, they have a course of 1 year or 2 year duration after either 8th standard or after the 10th standard. There are two varieties of programs that are there in ITIs, and they become technicians. But any technician, if he aspires to go up in the ladder, there must be opportunity to get into a diploma. That provision also exists. An ITI of 10th standard after 2 years can enter into direct second year of the diploma today. Today also it is available. Then those who have done diploma, they can enter into the direct second year of engineering. The engineering program is of 4 year duration, but they can enter into the direct second year and complete their degree in the next 3 years. That means after 10th standard, 3 years diploma and 3 years degree is equivalent to after 10 plus 2, 4 years of degree. So both are equal. Similarly, from ITI, one can go and become a degree holder. So all these facilities did exist earlier. Now, when we are talking about system of 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, the terminality in some sense comes at the end of 8th standard and end of 12th standard, present day 8th standard and 12th standard, or in the new 11 and 15 years of education after they enter into the system at the age of 3. So the terminality at the age of 10th standard of today does not exist in the new policy. And therefore, either at the end of 8th standard, one can get into an ITI kind of a system, or after 12th standard, one can come into a 4 year degree program in engineering. But there are exits possible at the end of 1 year with a certificate, 2 year with a diploma, 3 year with an advanced diploma, and so on. So that means the current diploma institutions may get merged into the engineering schools and they will become part of the entire technical education system per se itself. And then depending on when student wants to quit, you know, maybe because of financial difficulties in the family that someone wants to quit and take up a job early, or someone because of some difficulties temporarily wants to go out and come in later. So those things will be allowed with a provision of a certificate or diploma, even if someone quits in between. I think that is the beauty that is there in the new education policy. So the diploma or polytechnics, what the person Santosh Joshi is asking, will become part of the engineering education itself. So you should not be worried. no faculty will get retrenched. They will have a different role to play probably. That is what is going to happen.
Thank you very much, sir. It was indeed our great pleasure and privilege to listen to your words of wisdom. Hope all our teachers will take your message of converting information to knowledge and knowledge to wisdom. Thereby, we can bring back, we can beautifully blend the history of Bharat, the knowledge systems of India, and the needs of the 21st century learner. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks once again. We'll now move on to the second session. I request Sushma ma'am again to introduce the speaker, Dr. M.K. Sridhar. Thank you so much, Anil sir. Over to you, Sushma ma'am.
I will keep myself on listen, but I will be on the other mode.
Okay. All right, sir. All right. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Namaskar.
I'm truly honored to introduce to all of you.
Sushma ma'am.
Academician. Yes.
We are unable to hear you, ma'am.
I have unmuted myself, actually. Now, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm truly honored to introduce to all of you an eminent academician and recipient of Karnataka Rajyotsava Award, Dr. M.K. Sridhar, the speaker for the second technical session. Dr. M.K. Sridhar was a senior lecturer in commerce at Vijaya College, Bangalore, and later served as professor and dean at Canara Bank School of Management Studies, Bangalore University. He has successfully guided 4 MPhil, 11 PhD scholars, published 30 papers, and completed 11 research projects. He is a trainer and a social activist for social and national causes. Recognizing his vast experience in the field of education, research, and his passion for the nation, he has been nominated to prominent positions in various decision and policy-making bodies at the state and national level. He served as Member Secretary of Karnataka Knowledge Commission and Karnataka State Innovation Council of Government of Karnataka. He served as a member of Central Advisory Board of Education, MHRD, All India Board of Management Studies, AICTE. He is nominated by MHRD as a member of a committee for draft national education policy under the chairmanship of Dr. K. Kasturi Rangan. Presently, he is the executive council member of Central University of Kerala, president of Center for Educational and Social Studies, member of University Grants Commission, as well as the ICSSR Senior Fellow at ISEC Bengaluru. Disha has been fortunate to have him as a guiding council member since its inception. I request you, sir, to enlighten the participants on the topic NEP 2020, Vision of NEP. Thank you.
Ellarigu namaskara. Disha Bharatada Vatiyinda Ivattu ee karyakrama yen nadita ide Rashtriya Shikshana Neetige Hindaleyalli ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಭಾಗವಹಿಸುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಅವಕಾಶ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆ ನನ್ನ ಧನ್ಯವಾದ ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ. ದ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಹೂ ಸ್ಪೋಕ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಮೀ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಲೇಡ್ ಎ ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ ಫಾರ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಸ್ ಟು ಕ್ಯಾರಿ ಆನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸೆಷನ್. In fact, after listening to him, I felt that we did the right thing by having him as the first speaker. Yala Disha Bharatiya Sushma avre Bhavana avre mattu ulada yala karyakarta bandhugale college gula ಶಿಕ್ಷಕ ಬಂಧುಗಳೇ, ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳ ಆಡಳಿತ ಮಂಡಳಿಗಳ ಪ್ರತಿನಿಧಿಸುವಂಥ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಗಳೇ, ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದ ಪ್ರತಿನಿಧಿಗಳೇ ಮತ್ತು ಎಲ್ಲ ಬಂಧುಗಳೇ, ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಕೂಡ ಇವತ್ತು ಒಂದು ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ನೀತಿ ಬಂದಿರುವಂತ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ವಿಷಯದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಚರ್ಚೆ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕೆ ಸೇರಿ ನಾನು ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಂದುವರಿಸಲ
ಮಿಕ್ಸ್ಚರ್ ಕನ್ನಡ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ಇಸ್ ಬೆಟರ್ ಆಲ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಸರ್ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಸಿಪೆಂಟ್ಸ್
ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಐ ಫೀಲ್ ಈಸ್ This entire policy has taken 5.5 years to be prepared. And the input has been taken from at all levels. And finally, the policy has come. Now, it is also said that the policy will be applied up to 2040. That means for the next 20 years. In fact, if you take the first policy of our country, 1968, it was there for 18 years. Because 86, another policy came. And after 18 years in 1986, when another national policy came, that was there for 34 years. And then now a new policy is coming. If 86 policy was not changed in the last 34 years, it does not mean that it had a vision for 34 years. It was not changed, that's all. It was not revisited. But whereas in this policy, 2020 National Education Policy, there is a clear vision up to 2040. Vision is always something long term and which is something beyond today. See, if anything is only of today, it cannot be called a vision. Only if it is long term and if it is for tomorrow and day after, then only you can call it as a vision. Second thing, a vision cannot be a piecemeal thing. A vision cannot be, you know, in bits and pieces. It has to be holistic, it has to be integrated. See, let me tell you, for example, if there is a vision for an education policy only which deals with school education, then it cannot be a vision for education. Or if it deals with only technical education, it cannot be a kind of a vision. So therefore, the second thing for anything to have a vision is that it must be integrated and it must be holistic. The third one is, if you want to call anything as a vision, in terms of the time, you must have that all the three dimensions. You'll have to take learnings from your past. You'll have to stand on the present. And you'll have to jump for the future. That means I need to look back I need to stand on what I am today, and I need to jump for that which I want to become tomorrow. For example, you take any athlete. I always give this example of a long jump. If you have to jump, what do you do normally? You first go back. Am I right? You first go back. And then you start running towards the pole. And when you come to a stage that when you are to jump, you have to stand on that stick and then only jump. And when you jump, you will go far away and land yourself. Let me imagine. Can you jump without going back? Can you jump without holding that stick? And going back is like the past. Holding onto the stick is like the present. And jumping is like the future. So therefore, any vision need to have all these things. And how do you say that this policy has that vision? See, first of all, the vision of the policy is very evident because it is for the future and it is for the next 20 years. And it is integrated, holistic. It takes early childhood education, primary education, starting from age 3 up to 15 years, up to 18 years. Then it goes to higher education. And it touches all fields of higher education. It touches vocational education. It touches adult education. It also incorporates technology. It incorporates governance, regulation, autonomy, teaching, learning, teachers. You know, all possible things are there as part of this policy. So it is integrated and holistic. Third point, what I said, any vision must look into the past. Yes, the policy has gone very deep into the past. That's why it says India roots. I must feel happy, I must feel proud of myself being part of this great nation, which has more than 5,000 years of recorded history. I must take it to the past. I must take it. And then I must stand in the present. I must also know what are the current challenges, what are the current problems. And then only I'll have to think future. See, if any policy only talks about the past, does not connect to the present, and if any policy talks about only the present, does not take it derived from past or as well as talk about future. And any policy only talks about future in isolation cannot be a policy. So therefore, friends, what I would like to first put across to you is the policy has got a clear, very clear vision. ಒಂದು ದೂರದೃಷ್ಟಿ ಇದೆ. ಮುಂದಿನ 20 ವರ್ಷಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಇಡೀ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದ್ದು ಹೇಗಾಗಬೇಕು ಮತ್ತು ಆ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದಿಂದ ಜಗತ್ತಿನ ಒಂದು ಜ್ಞಾನದ ಜಗತ್ತಿಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಕೊಡುಗೆಯನ್ನು ಕೊಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ದೂರದೃಷ್ಟಿ ಇದೆ. ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ವಿಷನ್. ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ಸ್, ಲೆಟ್ ಮೀ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಟೇಕ್ ಯು ಥ್ರೂ. ವೆನ್ ಯು ಟಾಕ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ವಿಷನ್, there is a quality dimension, there is a quantity damage. What does the policy talks about the quantity? How is it the quantity oriented? It very clearly says the vision of the policy is, as far as school education is concerned, it is 100% gross enrollment ratio. All children coming to that age must be enrolled. They must continue. There should not be any dropout. And they must go up to the last point of that school education. That is 100% gross enrollment ratio. And when it comes to higher education, it talks about 50% gross enrollment ratio. That means in the age group of 18 to 23, 50% of the young population must be in higher education. Presently, it is 26%. So it must be doubled in the next 20 years. And there are a lot of other things. See, for example, there has to be, when it comes to vocational education, 50% of the student enrollment must be in, as far as possible, vocational education. And then it also says, you know, by 2030, all teachers, anybody who wants to become a teacher, has to complete 4-year integrated B.Ed. program. So like that, it talks about various targets which are quantitative. But there are any number of qualitative issues. I would like to touch upon 2-3 aspects which bother all of us. See, most of us are part of college system, and some of us are also part of university system. All these years, our entire system of education, higher education especially, was on university-centered higher education. That means all colleges used to be affiliated to the university, and the universities used to come out with the course design programs, and then they used to give the syllabus, how many hours, every details. Then they used to set the question paper, they used to conduct the examination, they used to carry on evaluation. Finally, they used to give the results and give the degree certificate. So most of the academic and educational activities were university-centered. That means everything was, the initiative used to come from university. But in the policy, the vision of the policy is not a centralized approach, is not a uniform approach, it is decentralized autonomous approach. See, there is a category which has been created in the policy, autonomous degree granting colleges. Autonomous degree granting colleges. Every college will become an entity. Now, whatever the university wants to do all these years will be carried out by the college, not immediately, after some time. So it becomes a kind of autonomous mini university. And suppose you have a college in Bangalore, or you have a college in Hubli, or you have a college in Chikkanaikanahalli, that college in that place will start develop programs which are relevant for those students, those youngsters, and those areas. We will not do it from Bangalore, or we will not do it from Delhi. Every college will be linked to their local situation, the kind of resources that they have, the kind of strengths that they have, the kind of competences that they have. All that will be taken care to design their own programs and come out with it. So if you have, let us imagine that you have a particular type of young community in that area which require a particular thing, then you will try to design it along with others. So it will be a college-centered approach. That is the vision of the policy. Vision, not immediately. It will take time. The second very important qualitative dimension of the vision of the policy is that it will be driven by teachers. It will be driven by the teachers who actually deliver and teach, not the teacher, you know, who will do it as per somebody else's instructions. I am a teacher. Let us imagine that I teach some three sections, 60 or 70 per section. Those 200 students, for them, what is the role that I play? I only teach and then answer their questions. That's all. I don't have any other role. If a student comes back to me and asks, "Sir, why this question has appeared like this?" I don't know, Baba. We need to ask the university. How I have done, sir? Can you give me some feedback? Where I am strong, where I am weak, can you tell me? How do I know? I don't value your papers. That means, and why this syllabus is like this, sir? Then the teacher will also say, "I don't know, this is what we have received from the university." That means a teacher does not have any stake in what he is trying to do. I have no stake. And the student will always look at the teacher as a representative of university only, not as his own teacher. So that teacher will be driving the system, that is the vision of the policy. And let me talk to you the another important dimension of the vision. What is that? It is purely, singularly oriented towards the student and the learner. So for example, all these years, what was the kind of approach? What I want, what I expect, what I need? I don't know. Somebody else used to decide the program. These are the subjects that you'll have to take. Whether I can take this and leave this? No, no choice. Whether I don't want this? No choice. For example, if you are a science student, you know, they have decided these are all the science subjects. Sir, I have some interest in economics. No, 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 no. The university doesn't permit you. You cannot take economics, huh? Sir, I have a lot of interest in economics. You may have interest, but you can't study. Or suppose a student says that I am studying mathematics. I want to pursue performing arts like dance. like dance. No, you cannot dance in the class, I say. Neither you can make me to dance, nor you can dance. You'll have to only do mathematics. So my needs, my requirements, my expectations, my skills, my competencies, my vocational dimensions, they were not at all given any attention. But this policy, in the name of, terminology of multidisciplinary, holistic education, the policy says, especially the students of undergraduate program, they can have different combinations, and there is no hard separation of art, science, commerce, and things like that. Even in secondary education, PUC, you will not have that differentiation. So friends, what I am trying to put across to you is, the vision of the policy is very, very clear, and it draws from the past, inspiration is from the past, and it tries to address the contemporary challenges and problems. At the same time, it takes you through a vision for future. If that doesn't happen, if I am there where I am, it cannot be called as a vision. And vision is not necessarily mental. See, first there has to be a mental vision. Then there has to be a physical vision. So the policy has given that mental vision. And it is for all of us to translate into physical vision. Means to make it to happen. This is where organizations like Disha Bharat, which is working very closely among teachers and students. I think if we can enthuse our students and teachers to take the spirit of the policy and think of the vision, I think we will be going forward. So friends, what I would like to end today is the policy has a vision not only to take care of your dimag, the policy is there also as a vision to take care of your dil. So this is a policy of dimag and dil. Dimag se dimag ke saath dil hai, dil ke aadhar par dimag karna, not merely dimag. Apne दिल को भी एक बार सोचिए, what is interest me, what is creating that passion in me. So the policy does not do much except that you are freed from that shackles, you are freed from that restrictions, you know, and you are allowed to blossom, you are allowed to grow, you are allowed to prosper. I think this is the only way to build a nation, and this is the only way to showcase Bharat, and this is the only way that we can develop. You know, we are taking inspiration from the past for what purpose? To build a greater future. I think that is possible, and this is the vision. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. M. K. Sridhar, sir. With your permission, would you like to take a couple of questions, sir?
Yeah, very much, please.
Yes. Sir, we had collected some questions during our registration, and one of the questions that was there was, so first of all, congratulations on drafting such a wonderful visionary policy. For a good understanding of the policy, we would like to know some of the major challenges that you underwent during the drafting of the policy itself.
See, first of all, I am not just alone in this process. Any number of people have joined, and it is the collective wisdom and aspiration of the people that this policy has resulted. Coming to challenges, see, I don't know whether you subscribe to this kind of a thinking on my part. In fact, let me, Dr. Anil will also vote for me. We have no challenges. What I mean by that is, see, when we were working on this policy, in fact, there was no pressure, there was no stress, there was no lobby. It was completely free from all this. So what happened is, we very coolly, we very, very, you know, smooth way, we started crystallizing our ideas and take it towards the policy. See, for example, when people came, when people met us, they were extremely good and they just gave the suggestions. And they never pressurized us. You should do this, you should not do this. And the government system, the bureaucracy and the political system, they gave us complete free hand. And you may not believe the kind of interactions we had with bureaucrats and politicians is very minimal. But they were only telling us, please feel free to come out with an extremely good policy. But let me tell you, then what made us to do this? What made us to do this is that we cumulatively, all of us, with the support of many of you, we could understand the aspirations of the people. This is what our people want. This is what our students want. This is what our teachers want. And that made us to come out. So therefore, I did not see much challenge, except that, but that there is a challenge of responsibility. There is a challenge of responsibility. You know, you are actually trying to do this for next to 20 years. So there is a great responsibility on your shoulders.
Thank you, sir. While reading the policy, we really understand it's a nation first policy. You've put the nation and all the interests of Bharat in front of, on top of anything else. Thank you very much for the answer. Another question is, NEP promotes multilingualism. Sir, how do you see this as an opportunity to preserve the language heritage via the classroom and teaching learning in the multilingual system?
Can you come again, Bhavana? Sorry.
The NEP promotes multilingualism. So our question to you, sir, is how do you see this as an opportunity, one, to preserve the rich knowledge heritage of India, and also two, how does teaching learning in the classroom happen in this multilingual setup?
See, it's a very important thing. Let me tell you, all those who have understood what is the real Bharat, you know, what is that real Bharat? It is actually the diversity, the different languages, the different traditions, the different practices. See, you get a feel. Hey, Bharat is not one, because there are so many languages, thousands of languages. Among tribals, there are hundreds and hundreds of languages. So generally, people all over the world, They are all monolithic systems. One language, one God, one temple kind of an approach. So people cannot understand what is the speciality of Bharat. That means what I am trying to say, Bhavana ji, you know, the diversity is the basic characteristic of Indian society. That's why your brain, your IQ levels, your performance, your behavior, your adjustment to people, the way you try to respond to others, all that is very great because of this diversity. So what we have done in this policy is, that multilingual approach has to start from age three. In fact, the policy says three language formula. And we have actually, if you go to the details, not just the 66 page policy, but 474 pages of Dr. Kasturi Rangan's report, we say it has been more than three languages also. Because it is very clearly said in brain research all over the world that neuroscience, you know, it has revealed the more languages you learn, the more languages you use, your tissues in the brain become more active. And tissues in the brain, if they become more active, your IQ levels, your performance levels, your energy levels, your contribution levels will be better. Therefore, from scientific research is one component. The second component is the societal reality. The societal reality is, you know, that you cannot only have one language. You cannot have only one language. See, for example, my mother may be having Telugu background. My father may be having Marathi background. My children, my brother will be talking more of English. Or my sister is married to somebody in North India, Hindi. You know, when I am in a social situation, I come across different languages. So therefore, what we have done is, without affecting the learning and the knowledge of the child, we have allowed that multilingualism. And even in higher education, you know, there has to be more and more scope for Indian languages. I'm not calling them as regional languages. They are all Indian languages. If Kannada, you cannot call it as it is a language of the region called Karnataka. No, it is one of the Indian languages. So there are, the higher education should also be offered in Indian languages. And for that sake, there are a lot of programs that are also given. Translation is given more importance. And even in research funding, there is a lot of component that will be from National Research Foundation. It will go for language research also. So to put the long story short, what I would like to say is the multilingualism is one of the basic characteristics of this policy based on scientific research and based on social reality and the vision for the future.
Thank you very much, sir. You have anekta me ekta. I think that was the message for a lot of us here. Sir, with your permission, one last question.
Yeah, please.
Yes. Sir, What is your message for academicians, teachers, heads of the institutions in understanding and implementing the NEP in the spirit of the policy?
Who am I to give a message to all such great people? I should not give a message. But as a colleague who was involved in this process, my only appeal to them is, my request to them is, it's not a message, my request to them is, I think if the national education policy, it's an opportunity. It's an opportunity. For me as an individual, for me as a community, for my institution, and for my society. It's an opportunity. It's a window of opportunity. So if we can make use of that, it is extremely good. In fact, in the last few months, apart from explaining the policy, some of us are also involved in trying to interact with institutions and individuals. Don't wait for the government. What the government does, what the government does not do is one thing. But what is that we can do? What is that I can do as a teacher? Let us start thinking. I think if this can happen, each of us, if I start thinking, what is that I can do? I think it will bring about that change. This is my request and appeal, not any message and things like that. I think all of us, if we put our effort together in that direction, I'm not saying this primarily because I was part of the policy and things like that. It is not a question of who was part of which policy, but it is an opportunity for all of us. Even if there is something not so good in the policy, possible. 100% cannot be said, and there can be always any kind of challenges in implementing. I agree. But I think it is a historical opportunity given that has come to all of us to knock at the doors of window of opportunity and go. So that's all my request.
Thank you very much. Dr. N.K. Sridhar, we were
good friend of mine.
We were indeed.
North University Professor Kemparaj. Be nice.
Yes, sir. So it was our privilege that you came and spoke on this occasion of Vikasana 2020. Thank you very much. Well, what I learned from your talk is, yes, we have beautiful roses. Let's just not pluck the flower and make a bouquet, but let's plant more rose plants and make a beautiful garden. So I think that's where we connect the root, the shoot, and the future, the past, the present, and the future. So thank you very much, sir. Over to Sushma ma'am for introduction of our next guest speaker, Dr. C.N. Ashwath Narayan, sir.
C.N. Ashwath Narayan, Deputy Chief Minister and Minister for Higher Education, IT and BT, needs no introduction to the academicians gathered here. A politician, but an educationist at heart, Dr. Ashwath Narayan is very popular amongst all the teaching fraternity in the state. I am truly humbled to introduce a person of his stature on this occasion. Dr. C.N. Ashwath Narayan, a medical doctor by profession, has held positions of Founder President, Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences Employees Association, Syndicate and Senate Member, Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences, Senate Member, Bangalore University, in addition to his prominent positions in the Bharatiya Janata Party, Karnataka. Presently, as Deputy CM and Education Minister, he has taken upon himself the mantle of implementation of NEP 2020 in the state. I request Dr. C.N. Ashwath Narayan Deputy CM to deliver his address. Thank you.
Namaskara. Good morning. Disha Bharat Vikasana is organizing a program on implementation of National Education Policy 2020, the role of educational institution, distinguished dignitaries and participants. National Education Policy 2020 is a visionary and a bold policy formulated for aspiring India of 21st century. It is aligned to Sustainable Development Goal 4 of United Nations, which seeks to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all by 2030. The policy is forward-looking, ambitious, and has an intent for building strong India for 21st century. The aspirations and goals of NEP will have to be realized through an ecosystem that is enabler and accelerator of learning. Educational institutions have to offer such ecosystem that transforms youth into collaborators in nation development, national development, contributing to making the world sustainable one. A good education institution, a good educational institution is one in which every student feels welcome and cared for, where a safe and a stimulating learning environment exists, where a wide range of learning experiences are offered, and where good physical infrastructure and appropriate resources conducive to learning are available to all students. Attaining these qualities must be the goal of every educational institution. NEP mentions a set of fundamental principles that will guide both the educational system at large and as well as the individual institutions. The major ones related to educational institutions and curriculum are recognizing, identifying, and fostering the unique capabilities of each student by sensitizing teachers as well as parents to promote each student's holistic development in both academic and non-academic spheres. Flexibility, so that the learners have the ability to choose their learning trajectories and programs and thereby choose their own paths in life according to their talents and interests. No hard separation between arts and science, between curricular and extracurricular activities, between vocational and academic streams, etc. In order to eliminate harmful hierarchies among and silos between different areas of learning, multidisciplinary and a holistic education across the science, social science, arts, humanities, and sports for a multidisciplinary world in order to ensure the unity and integrity of all knowledge. Emphasis on conceptual understanding rather than rote learning and learning for exams. Creativity and critical thinking to encourage logical decision making and innovation. Ethics and human and constitutional values like empathy, respect for others, cleanliness, courtesy, democratic spirit, spirit of service, respect for public property, scientific temper, liberty, responsibility, pluralism, equality, and justice. Promoting multilingualism and the power of language in teaching and learning. This is most important, which we need to understand since we are living in a diverse country, in a diverse society, unity in diversity and respecting each other's culture is the most important aspect of any order across the world. So in this direction, the sensitivity and sensitiveness has to be promoted, sensitizing each and every person to understand the way we need to live and respect for each other is the most important, which has to be inculcated among the children or the students. Life skills. Some of the most important aspect, introvert and extrovert, we do learn a lot of things, but ultimately we need to be an extrovert to handle the real situation, the real life. For this, we need a lot of life skills such as communication, cooperation, teamwork, and resilience. So these aspects will be given a lot of importance, not just limiting to the academic work by the respective institution. Focus on regular formative, something, a formula very precisely what should be the learning. It is very clear, rather than a summative assessment that encourages today's coaching culture. So in this direction, formative assessment will go a long way in really realizing the real quality, the real understanding, where we stand, what is the kind of quality. It is not just the pass percentage. It is the real learning, what happens in each individual and each student matters a lot. Then we'll know where we stand, how things have to be addressed, how things can be taken forward by each of the institution. So that will make them to look into critique, not only being critical, creative about a student, the each institution needs to become critical, creative about their own aspect and their own concepts of, you know, fundamentals has to be strongly addressed through this kind of assessment. So extensive use of technology in teaching and learning, removing language barriers, increasing access to Divyang students and educational planning and management. The most important, the technology enablement can change many of the things and we can get best of the best resource, and whatever facilitation needs to happen, the best resource can be accessed through technology and facilitated. Every possible continuous and comprehensive learning, assessment, everything of the teacher, student, it can happen very easily with regard to the formulative assessment. Formative assessment can happen more effectively through technology, and technology can facilitate many of the things to change. The way the learning happens or the teaching happens also can change, and the management of the entire program can happen very effectively. Respect for diversity and respect for local context in all curriculum is most important to promote the local culture, language, all aspects of the local area needs to be promoted, pedagogy and policy, always keeping in mind that education is a concurrent subject. Synergy in curriculum across all levels of education, from early childhood care and education to school education to higher education. Outstanding research as a core requisite for outstanding education and development. We need to build our educational infrastructure, including the educational institutions, based on these fundamental principles. NEP has proposed radical changes in the structure of our educational system that will equip us to cater to the stated aspirations and goals. The product that comes out of this educational institution should be able to face the problems of the world that is described as VUCA, world characterizing it as volatile, uncertain, complex and ambiguous world. This is most important aspect because we'll be in a totally unrealistic world while we are learning. So during learning, these aspects has to be kept in mind by the institution to prepare the students who will emerge as a graduate to face the real world, which is in the terms of world characterizing volatile, uncertain and complex and ambiguous world. Today's world is undergoing rapid changes in the knowledge landscape with various dramatic scientific and technological advances such as rise of big data, machine learning and artificial intelligence. Many unskilled jobs worldwide have been taken over by machines. While the need for a skilled workforce, particularly involving mathematics, computer science and data science in conjunction with the multidisciplinary abilities across the science, social science and humanities will be increasingly in great demand. With climatic change, increasing pollution and depleting natural resources, there will be a sizable shift in how we meet the world's requirement of energy, water, food and sanitation needs, again resulting in the need for new skilled labor. It keeps changing, the requirement keeps changing depending on the situations, particularly in biology, chemistry, physics, agriculture, climate science and social science. The growing emergence of epidemics and pandemics will also call for collaborative research in infectious disease management and development of vaccines, and the resultant social issues highlighted the need for multidisciplinary learning. There will be growing demand for humanities and art as India moves towards becoming a developed country as well as among the three largest economies in the world. Our education should be mindful of these changes and use it as opportunities. Government of Karnataka wishes to be the first state in the country to implement NEP 2020, having good number of institutions of national importance, having been the architects of NEP from Karnataka, having knowledge commission, etc., are working to the advantage of our state in the terms of understanding NEP and preparing the state for implementation. We wish to be the major contributor to national growth through transforming the educational ecosystem of Karnataka by implementing NEP 2020. With these few words, I would like to stop here. And even the many of the reforms strengthening, facilitating or supporting the educational institution will be coming out with many of the support system in terms of institutional support regarding the finance, structures for the promoting or building of the infrastructure, what needs to be done, the kind of support system, the reforms in legislatively, administratively, in the governance. Will be bringing a lot of reforms to facilitate a lot of good things to happen. So always we are there to ensure whatever needs to be done any given time, we are willing to take it up and ensure that the implementation of NEP will happen very successfully to facilitate for the transformation of the entire society, which is happening after 34 years. I think this is the way forward for the sustainability of Chapter 4 of United Nations. I think this is the way forward which we need to hold on to education reforms. This is the solution, this is the future through which we can build our society. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Kannada.
Thank you very much, Dr. C. N. Ashwath Narayan, sir. It was our privilege to have you speak on. Happy to have such an understanding government who are ready to take NEP to the next level, be implemented smoothly in the institutions in Karnataka. Now, with these words, we come on to the final session of today's webinar. And to conduct this session, I would like to invite Srimati Rekha Ramachandran, the founder and secretary of Disha Bharat. She is a master's graduate in economics from the University of Madras. She has authored many national and international papers on value initiative and also organized national and international conferences. She is the member of ethical committee of SDM Ayurvedic College, Bangalore, and the ICC committee at Pesset University, also in Bangalore. Ma'am, welcome you, and over to you for the next session.
Thank you, Bhavna. Thank you so much. Namaste, and a warm welcome to all of you on behalf of Disha Bharat. a great insight to all of us in the last three sessions. It's been really, really great listening about the NEP. Yes, NEP is a truly visionary document, and it is very futuristic when you talk about Bharat, and very holistic in particular about education. We can expect it's a great game changer, undoubtedly a game changer, and we can expect a great Bharat and a very glorious Bharat again. So hats off to the founding fathers of this NEP 2020, and a big congratulations and hearty congratulations to all of them on behalf of Disha Bharat too. Now, why is Disha Bharat so excited, or why are we so happy about this NEP 2020? Because Disha Bharat is a non-profit social initiative, and we have worked towards holistic education, which the NEP 2020 talks about. For the last 15 years, untiringly, we've been working towards giving a holistic approach to education. So the last 15 years has been very, very enriching for the entire Disha Bharat here. Why? Because, you know, we talk about a personality, we build a personality, we create a great youth, because youth are so instrumental in building the nation's progress. When we talk about a personality or building a nation, it's so important that we talk about value education. And when we talk about a value education, Disha Bharat, the theme of Disha Bharat is know yourself, know your country, and know your culture. People might be asking, when it comes to values, yes, values are important for the education, but why country and culture? Friends, we all know culture is a great influencer. It is so important that culture gives us a sort of identity as to who we are. And this identity comes from the country, the value systems that the country carries. So it becomes very imperative and important that we talk about personality of development or value education at the background of country and culture. So what happens when we talk about know yourself, know your country, know your culture? Our experience in the last 15 years, lakhs of youth we have reached, and what is that we have experienced is definitely this education makes the student much more holistic in terms of thinking and the perspectives. So this is what Disha has been doing. And what we can do, this kind of personality development or value education creates strong children, strong youth with character and integrity. And there's a personal transformation that takes place. And in turn, there is societal transformation. So transform you to transform nation is the idea or the vision of Disha. Now, how do we do it? How do we do this? First of all, why Disha? Why Disha? All of us, many of us in this group also know Disha very well. There are a lot of colleges, principals who have been a part of Disha initiatives, Disha Bharat initiatives. So when we talk about the Disha Bharat initiatives, now we all see here, literacy. Today's current education system highlights, focuses much on the three R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. But yes, not to forget, there are a lot of social problems and there are a lot of things that takes place in spite of the fact that there is so much of literacy all around. So then why? When there is so much of literacy, when there is so much of social evils, can we then equate literacy with education? My dear friends, definitely not. It is time, and thanks to the NEP 2020, that they have made this values an integral part of the education system. And that makes education holistic, more complete. Education is more complete when we talk about literacy plus the values. And how does Disha do this? And we all know that these are the five quotients need to be sensitized when it comes to holistic education of a child. We ought to sensitize them in a holistic approach. There are five important quotients. Spiritual, this emotional, you can see that social quotient, spiritual, physical, emotional, and intellectual. All these quotients need to be touched upon. And we all know as teachers, today's students, our intellectual quotient is so high, but emotionally, the emotional quotient is a bit low because of the system. There is no way forward for them. Suddenly, they're not able to take the challenges of life. Why? It is because of the holistic approach is not available. So the foundation of character, country, culture, and sensitizing the five quotients makes education holistic. And this is what is the approach of Disha that we've been doing for the last 15 years. Now, how this particular vision and mission of Disha translate into action? what we do is, yes, these are the in-campus student programs, the workshops, life skills programs, leadership programs, internship programs, programs in the NSS. And in the corona time, we had another online program called Unleash the Hidden Potential. And of course, many of the colleges in Karnataka know as we take Swami Vivekananda Jayanti every year and pass on the message of Vivekananda. I mean, when we talk about Swami Vivekananda, we have two important messages the Swamiji says is one is character building, other is nation building. It is so important that this message percolate to the youth of this country so that they become change agents. We want the youth to become change agents. And so for the last, from the year 2008, we have been conducting Swami Vivekananda Jayanti intercollegiate events. And we also go to various colleges and schools to talk about Swamiji's message in the month of January. Having said that, there are so many principals when we went and approached for Disha programs. They said, this education that you're giving is very important, but it needs to start at a much earlier age. Because when they come to a college, they're a little, you know, they're more rigid. But at a much younger age, the children are much more flexible to take the values. And that is when Disha Bharat started the school unit and high school unit called Viveka Vikasa. And from 8 high school students, Viveka Vikasa has been untiringly working, imparting these value educations on the same grounds of country and culture. And we have been touching so many thousands and thousands of children on the same theme. And online programs are also going on in Disha. And my dear friends, we are proud to say through various programs of Disha, we have touched more than 4 lakh students, youth, across Karnataka, Andhra, and Tamil Nadu. So this is a great thing for Disha, undoubtedly. Yes. And then the next important aspect of Disha, the programs that we have conducted, is a My Bharat online campaign in the year 2020. Friends, when we talk about 2020, as our Bhavana said, definitely, yes, the corona thing has been very it was very deep in our minds. But undoubtedly, 2020, there's a brighter side of 2020 for the education. That is a policy initiative from the government of India. And secondly, for Disha, why this is so important is we have been able to go online. We've been able to touch so many children on the things of country and culture. We wanted to do this 1st of August to 15th of August. We had 2 programs, one in the morning session of My Bharat campaign, which touched the students of this country. And second program was in the evening, where you can see on your screens, very important people, eminent people came and spoke about the history, the past, and the futurist India. That is what they spoke. But why this My Bharat campaign? Very important, because Sri Aurobindo says, a country whose young minds are inspired by the glories of the past, pains of the present, and dreams of the future move on the path of progress. It is so important that our youth know and understand what is the past, what are the glories of the past, what is the saga of sacrifice, what is the freedom movement, how many people have contributed, more than 6 lakh people have sacrificed towards this freedom movement. It is time our children understand and look back about this country's history with so much of pride and so much of responsibility that they have. It is so important. That is why this My Bharat campaign was an outreach program where we touched more than 12 lakh people. And it was a very hit campaign during the year 2020. So these are the various programs that we have done for students and teachers. Having said about the My Bharat campaign, Prerana, we have prayer, students program and teachers program. Both are very important when we talk about education. Why? Why is it so important? Because teachers are the custodian of values, my dear friends. As you're all sitting here, you all know that as teachers, you are custodians of values and the backbone of education system. Just now, all our important people in this NEP have said that the NEP is also teacher-driven. They've talked about teachers in a big way, saying that teachers are the main people in this NEP and they have to be sensitized. So remember, teachers are, they have, when they talk about the custodian of values, it is very important. They are worthy of emulation. They become role models. Many, many times it so happens, children might not remember your class, but definitely they remember you as a teacher. How and why? Because of the value systems that the teacher carries, and that you have made a huge difference in that particular student's life. They remember the teacher. So that is how we started the student prayer and our teacher faculty development programs, journey from teacher to a guru. And here you can see on your left hand side that we have done so many programs when it comes to faculty development program. The eternal torch bearers in the ever-changing world is our online program during the corona time. We have also had state level programs. We have had national level conferences for teachers. And we also had principals conclave in the year 2019. And all these teacher programs revolve around the theme, value initiatives, the challenges, and the way forward. So how individual institutions can take these value initiatives so that it percolates to the end beneficiary, and that is the student. So these are our, by and large, all the programs of Disha. One is the student, one is the teacher, and one is for the general public, that is the My Bharat. These are the various programs we've been doing for the last 15 years, and we've had a very good outreach of all these programs. Now, having said that, in what way, what is the connect between NEP and Disha? This is Disha Bharat. This is something very, very important that we have. There's a great connect between NEP and Disha Bharat when we talk about why. Because Disha Bharat has been resonating the important values and the vision that NEP is talking about. We can see here on the left hand side is the vision of the NEP, the education system rooted in Indian mythos. Just now our Dr. MKS very beautifully said, and also our Anil Sister Uday sir have spoken about why we go to the past. It is so important, and they all said about very beautifully, they've already covered this point, which I don't want to touch again. So the vision of the NEP document talks about the education system rooted in Indian ethos, equitable and vibrant knowledge society, instill among the learners a deep-rooted pride and being Indian in thought, spirit, and deed. This is what the vision of the NEP 2020 talks. Now, they have given, the NEP creators have given us next 5 years for the thing to be implemented. So the structural, governance, and the regulatory changes described in the policy will take another 5 years for the institutions and all the education stakeholders to implement this vision. But they have given enough time for us to prepare ourselves, the sort of preparedness towards implementing it in the next 5 years. So what as institutions and the stakeholders we need to do is understand the undercurrent theme of the NEP. And this is the focus area you see on the right-hand side. So this undercurrent that we are talking about, the preparedness that Disha Bharat is talking about, is that every institution needs to prepare itself in these 5 areas. That is the focus area. We need to understand and start working from now so that we understand and address the needs of the millennial learners, one. Secondly, we embrace the NEP 2020 with so much of, you know, with a welcome. We can welcome the NEP with so much of appreciation for it and the responsibility from our side. So the policy holders have given envisioned it in a very beautiful way. So let us ensure that we as different stakeholders translate this into action and start preparing ourselves. And that is why Disha Bharat has taken this initiative, because Disha Bharat has resonated with the objectives. I mean, we have been so far ahead. I mean, with pride we can say, and with a sense of responsibility, here I would like to say that we as an organization have thought about this kind of holistic education 15 years before. And for the last 15 years, this is exactly what this undercurrent NEP talks about, or the vision it talks about. We have been doing it in various institutions, and that's how I'm saying we have touched 4 lakh students on this vision of the NEP. And the next thing, what exactly is, yes, NEP's focus area and that connect to Disha Bharat. Friends, I just spoke to you about what are the various programs that we do in the colleges. And definitely the student programs we have done, it's definite. These are the programs. That is the human excellence programs, life skills, Namaste India. Human excellence program is the personality development programs done by Disha. It is our signature program. We sensitize the students on the 3 C's that we are talking about: country, character, country, culture. and the methodologies we use is so beautiful. It is so fun-filled, so enriching, and lot of knowledge and lot of team building happens in these programs and courses of Disha. At end of all our programs, the students come back to say that it is not only fun and fun-filled and but lot of knowledge has been given and there is lot of transformation. And we can vouch for one fact that Disha Bharat has definitely sown the seeds of change and transformation through these human excellence programs. And of course, our life skills programs, where life skills we talk in the background of the Indian ethos. It is so important when skill, we don't talk in skills in isolation, definitely not. Because when we talk about a skill, there is so important, the important is that we have a value-based in skills. It is so important because when you talk about communication skills or interpersonal skills, or there are so many skills that we talk about in the corporate terminology. But yes, when we have to go into an inward journey, when the Disha Bharat ensures and enables the students to go into an inward journey, the life capable and work capable knowledge that we want to impart to our students, what we do is, we ensure that all our programs are filled with the values of the Indian ethos filled in it so that they understand the pride of this country. Namaste India. This is another great signature program of Disha too, because we have great quiz. It could be state level, national level. We have conducted quizzes on the contribution of our Indian heritage, Indian scientific heritage, Indian culture, Indian monuments, various subjects we touch in the quiz. And through these programs, Namaste India programs, we sensitize the students on, wow, there's so much of the thing that our country has given, because many, many times our youth have a feeling that India is a very poor country and India is a very illiterate country, but they must understand that India is a glorious country with a rich past. India has been a very, very literate country, contributing so much in terms of science and technology, mathematics and all the field branches of study. It is not that we have only contributed, but there is so much to know, and the students need to start doing some research. The really interested students, we trigger, kindle their interest to go into research and make a great contribution from their side to build India, take India to the next level. This is what we do through all these programs and our programs for NSS students, where we enable community services. We go to the enable NSS camps and talk about the community services. And here, NEP also focuses on community participation. Seva, they've used the word seva. Lessons in seva and service is that phrase that NEP has used. Having said that, Disha Bharat has a tie-up with the Youth for Seva. Today, they are also our official partners in this program. And Youth for Seva is a very important organization meant for community service, because Youth for Seva talks about there are a lot of people who want to do service and there are a lot of people who need the service. And Youth for Seva definitely ensures they bridge this thing and they enable them to come together, and all of them are benefited out of this seva. So Disha has an organizational tie-up with this Youth for Seva to take these community services forward. And when we talk about Disha internship, just now our Anil Sastrabude sir so beautifully talked about how we need to take our students to the tribal people and talk to them, how they need to understand their feelings, their problems, all that Anil ji was talking so beautifully. This is exactly what we do in Disha internships too, my dear friends. Because this internship for students, we ensure that the students come face to face with the social realities. Not only that they come face to face with social realities, many times they feel so, they're so troubled by the realities of the society. And there were students who came in after the internship and they said, I was living in a very secluded world, in a very happy world, thinking things are so beautiful. But only when I came to the internship, when I saw the society, I realized the other side of the society, the harder reality of the society. And not only that, we also enable the students to come and meet the successful role models, the real role models of the society. who have come out and made a big difference to the society. So we tell the students that you are such change agents. You need to come and do something for the society. You have to do, you become contributors to the society is what we talk in the Disha internships. 15 days internship. And one more thing, then after the internship program, students say, if we want to stay back in Disha and learn so much, there's so much of learning that has happened in Disha internships is what the students have come and told to us. That is what is Disha internship about. And like, of course, as I spoke about Swami Vivekananda Jayanti, this is also another very good program from Disha. We've been doing this for the last 13 years. And Swami Vivekananda is, you know, he is the architect of New Age Bharat. He's done so much for, if at all world recognizes India as a great country, as a Bharat Mata, as a Vishwa Guru, the all credits to Swami Vivekananda, his contribution and his message. And students, the youth must know what Swamiji has said. And more and more we give the message of Swami Vivekananda, students will understand that as youth, I have a great role to play in building this country. So that is why we've been doing this program also. And all these programs in sync with the NEP's vision, my dear friends. That is why Disha Bharat talks about NEP with so much of pride and so much of happiness. Now, Prerana, journey from teacher to a guru. This is something very, very important. This program, as again, so much of the thrust and stress is given on the teacher. Why journey from teacher to a guru? We are all teachers. Can we become guru? Which means, are you taking us back to the, you know, Gurukula system? Definitely not. Because the gurus here are the teachers. Teachers are meant to become gurus, become the acharyas, become the role models. And they are the catalyst of change, catalyst of social change to bring about a healthier society and make a huge, make a architects of the new age Bharat. Why? What is the difference? Why we talk about a guru here? Guru, a gu means ignorance. Guru is the one who removes. So a guru is the one who removes the ignorance from the mind of the student. And so guru in our shastras, in our culture, a guru has a very important place and position because we respect him, we revere him, and we emulate him. So now in the modern day current education system, each one of us in this program, the teachers are undoubtedly gurus. What is the difference? See, you know, as a teacher, we say we go through life. We enable the students to go through life. But a guru understands and he enables the students to grow through life. Very important. Secondly, as a teacher, we give information. But here, a guru enables transformation. The very thought process, there is a change. And teacher covers the syllabus. It is important that a teacher covers the syllabus, but a guru uncovers the mind and discovers the, enables the student to discover the higher purpose of life. And I think this is what we all as teachers in this particular group need to do, that we need to, we must understand, facilitate the students to uncover their mind and discover a higher purpose in life. And so that each and every student, each and every youth will make a difference in his life and they make a difference to the nation at large. So this is so important, and that as from teacher to a guru, because again, I'm telling you, it's so important because a teacher, when, you know, when a bus driver makes mistake, maybe 60 lives are lost. When a pilot makes a mistake, 360 lives are lost. But when a teacher makes mistake, my dear friends, a generation is lost. Let us not waste a single moment. Let us all elevate to that status of a guru and make a difference to this NEP and implement it in letter and spirit. Now, what Disha Bharat does for the faculty development programs? This again, on the left side of your screens, you can see the focus area of the NEP 2020. And friends, I would like to tell you one thing. All that NEP 2020 focus area, whatever we have written there, it is taken from the NEP document itself. All the phrases, we have not included anything. It is completely, every letter there is from the NEP 2020. So what Disha Bharat has been doing to create such gurus? We have been, as I told you, journey from teacher to a guru. Our faculty development programs are again a very big hit amongst the colleges because we first and foremost, we create a sense of pride and passion in the profession. This is something very important that teachers carry that the pride. As long as we don't have pride in the profession, maybe yes, we'll not be that teacher we ought to be. We cannot make changes. We cannot become that kind of role models which we are expected to. Secondly, we have value-based faculty development programs. We have academic leadership programs and activity-based learning pedagogies. Because generally what happens in colleges, the faculty development programs have, they conduct a lot of FDPs and are concerned to the subject. It is connected to the subject-oriented FDPs. There are lots of it happening so that a teacher gets a deeper insight about the subject. But in Disha, as we told you, the value-based faculty development programs, there's so much of activities. Here also it is again activity-based programs. So every activity itself is a pedagogy for the student, for the teachers to take it to the classrooms. And every activity is so interesting and so beautiful that they can convert these pedagogies into their, making it more learner-centric and take it to the beneficiaries and make education more and more interesting. And very importantly, as a teacher, how, when the learning happens for the student, how we integrate values with our subjects. This is something very important because we cannot talk of values isolatedly. We cannot talk. And one more very important thing is the current NEP 2020 talks of a very collaborative approach, multidisciplinary approach. So no more time, gone will be the times when a department has an edge over the other departments. It is not so anymore. We are going to go, it is all, and a very holistic approach is going to take place in this NEP, cross-disciplinary, interdisciplinary thinking and working should start. And this is where Disha again enables this particular approach. And masterclass in Indian knowledge system, we have a lot of, Disha is blessed with a lot of eminent people who are very, eminent in their particular field and masters in their field, who come and sensitize our teachers on how to take their subjects forward to the classroom. So this is what we do through the faculty development programs. Now, my dear friends, Vikasana NEP 2020 Vision to Action. Disha Bharat is so keen on taking this NEP 2020 forward to every individual institution. So the broad things what Vikasana is planning to do, the next 12 months starting from December, 12 months, we are going to have a series of programs sensitizing the teachers, that is a training of the trainers from the Disha Bharat, where we are going to take, again, conduct the value-based faculty development programs. And again, as I just said, bringing in experts and how to enable the integration of values in the already set curriculum. Because, see, one thing is NEP is going to be implemented 5 years down the line, which means the next 5 years, students, are they going to miss out something? No, let us not base their, this next 5 years too, let the students be lucky enough to have the, get the glimpse of the NEP and they become the students or the citizens that they ought to be. So we are going to do this or enabling the integration of values in the already set curriculum by bringing experts in the field. Thirdly, insight into country and culture. This is something again, multidisciplinary when it comes, we have to bring an insight into the teachers for which we conduct this. You can see on the orientation program here, what we have mentioned, quality education for self and societal transformation. And that is a quest program. That is a credit program, a credit course offered by Disha for both teachers and students, where we can bring experts and that's a 32-hour credit, but we will customize it based on the need of the institutions. We can do these programs. And the Seva project, as I just said, we have a tie-up with Youth for Seva, and Youth for Seva, along with Disha, we are going to do programs. In fact, in the induction programs of the colleges too, Youth for Seva has already been across India. They have got internships and they've got working across India and a lot of colleges and many. They're working in 5 different verticals. So they are doing a tremendous job in this field. And so when it comes to community service, they are the leaders and we have a tie-up with Youth for Seva. And importantly, this Ek Bharat Shreshth Bharat, what this is again the quote from NEP. It is not again Disha's. NEP is talking about Ek Bharat Shreshth Bharat. Here what Disha intends to do is, we want to have online virtual tours for the students. NEP says, identify 100 different destinations, talk about it, the pride of the monument, the pride of the destination, and its significance of the destination, so that our children understand the pride of it. So we want to take the students on the, as of now, it is virtual tours, and in the future, definitely the physical tours too, where it is going to be a very, very enriching and understanding of this great country and its great past. It is, we are going to enable through this Ek Bharat and Shreshth Bharat. So these are the Vikasana NEP 2020 Vision to Action. Visha has got great plans, and we request the institutions who want to implement this NEP to come and sign up with us, so that we can take this forward together as stakeholders. Let us all take forward together is what our request to all of you through this program. Now, having said all this, my dear friends, we have come to the last thing, because it is so important. As we said, NEP is undoubtedly a visionary document. Hats off to the founding fathers. So it is a responsibility of each one of us in this group to implement this in letter and spirit. So what should and letter in spirit, and ensure that we create youth who look back with pride and who look forward with confidence and conviction, thus become contributors and change agents of this country, and become take Bharat Mata to the next level. As we see very beautifully, you know, what we need to do now as educators, what we need to do is, let us redefine education. Let us redesign the curriculum. Let us rededicate ourselves to rebuild this great nation. Come on, my dear friends. We'll all march together. March together, and there we see Swami Vivekananda's quote, as he says that, "One vision I see clear as life before me, that the ancient mother is awakened once more, sitting on her throne, rejuvenated, more glorious than ever she was. Proclaim her to the world with a voice of peace and benediction." My dear friends, let us all march towards this goal together, and ensure that we join hands and we take Bharat Mata to the next level, and ensure that we are all marching towards the Vishwa Guru Bharata. Thank you all so much for being a part of this program. Thank you once again. It's been really enriching for us through this program. We got to meet so many people. Thank you again. Namaste.
Thank you so much, Rekha ma'am, for your talk. Ma'am, we have a couple of questions that I have received on my chat. One was, there was a touch and go of the quest, a bit more on the quest program, it would be nice.
Ma'am, can you repeat the question?
Ma'am, one of our participants wanted to know a little more on the quest programs.
Huh. Yes, quest program is a credit course that we have come out with. It is about, again, it talks about know yourself, know your country, know your culture, where it is, we have given a 32-hour credit course, okay, where the students, and because when we talk about the student credit course, the insight of this country and culture first has to be given to the teachers, because again, the end users are the beneficiaries are the students, and teachers need to take it to their classes. The rich heritage of this country and the great, glorious past, and the emotional, there in the quest program, know yourself, we talk about the emotional intelligence part, the self-awareness part, which is so important, how the teachers can enable the emotionally balanced children. That is something we address there. And about the heritage, which is the NEP 2020 talks about, the scientific heritage, the, you know, the cultural heritage of this country, we give a deeper insight, bringing the right kind of resource people for each of their subjects, so that the teachers are oriented towards the quest course, and they can take it forward and pass it on to the students. This is what is the quest all about.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you very much. Another question was, they wanted to know a little bit more about the faculty development program and how it is done.
Faculty development program, Prerna, journey from teacher to a guru. One thing is, as we told you, this journey. Gurudva is so important, and all the programs here focus on the values. We have the programs where we have discussions with teacher on building their emotional quotient, because every teacher, we have a small group discussions in these programs where the teachers, you know, there are many, many times teachers are not able, they're not being heard many times. I'm sorry to say this, but they say that faculty development programs, Prerana has heard what the teachers are going through. They have their own queries, they have their own problems, which they discuss in the group discussion sessions. And we have a case analysis sessions there where teachers, as teachers have to interact with the management, they have to interact with the head of the institutions, they have to interact with the students, they have to interact with the parents. So there is a, I mean, they have a multiple people there they have to, they come in contact with. So what are the challenges in each of these areas that they interact with, and what is the way forward for them? This is something we do in our case analysis sessions. And in, we have another important aspect in our Prerana, that is teachers are responsible for four different things. One is personally, they are responsible for the personal transformation. That is the agenda of the personal transformation where they need to change. Secondly, they are responsible for the students where they become role models and change the students. Thirdly, they are very, very important for the institution because they are the face of the institution. And fourthly, they are very instrumental in building a new age Bharat. So they have four big responsibilities. Teachers, when we talk about teachers, they have four big responsibilities to fulfill. So Disha Bharat, through our Prerana programs, we talk about how to fulfill these four responsibilities through activity-based learning of the teachers. And last but not the least, it is the session is on inspiration, where we bring eminent speakers who have been role model teachers themselves to give the way forward and how to show the passion and commitment towards their profession. So this is what they get, a holistic view of the teachership in our Prerana programs. Thank you, Bhavana.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I think there are more questions on how Disha can be contacted for each of the programs and what are the programs. We'll definitely respond to all of them on our chat.
Sure.
Thank you so much for your session, Rekha, ma'am. For the vote of thanks, now we have come to the end of this webinar. We had enlightening talks right from Dr. Anil Sahasrabuddhe, sir, to Dr. MKS, M.K. Sridhar sir, Dr. Ashwath Narayan sir, and now Rekha ma'am. So to deliver the vote of thanks, I would like to request Srimati Parimala Murthy, the director of Viveka Vikasa, the school wing of Disha Bharat, to render the vote of thanks. Thank you so much. Over to Parimala ma'am.
Thank you, Bhavana. Namaste, everyone. विद्या ददाति विनयम् विनयात्याति पात्रताम् पात्रत्वात् धनमाप्नोति धनात् धर्मं ततः सुखम्. All of us want happiness, but that comes only with vidya, and from there we move on to vinaya, and then patrata, having a flawless character. So our new education policy has given a lot of importance and emphasized on all the topics that we have seen so far. At the outset, in the beginning, I would like to offer my humble pranams and dhanyavad and thanks to Dr. Anil Sahasrabuddhe, Indian Education System. He is part of this, and AICTE. And the important points that he said is that really inspired me as an individual, and I would also be representing all your thoughts when I say this. Bharat, our country, has a big role to play in the future learning norms without stress, and thereby leading to innovation, and that too learning for a child from their childhood in mother tongue and various other languages. And we saw that a student learns in various languages, that also improves the students or the learners' capacity in innovating and in creativity. So knowledge leads to wisdom, and it leads to us contributing a lot for the society, which has to be useful, powerful, and progressive as ever. And here, teacher as champions of chance, he says that we as teachers should take an oath, not just to fight for our rights, but to fulfill our duties and responsibilities, which are very, very important for a teacher. And second, I would like to thank Dr. M.K. Sridhar Makkam, who threw light on the entire new education policy 2020 as he was part of the drafting committee. And as he said, the incorporation of technology and values along with skills goes hand in hand. And this is where Disha Bharat is playing a major role in inculcating value education along with the other learnings that we get to see. I would also like to thank our Honorable Deputy Chief Minister of Karnataka, Dr. C.N. Ashwath Narayana, who threw light again on the importance of creativity and learning through technology. What he said was, every student should be provided a conducive atmosphere, and only that can encourage creativity and contribution from the students, which is very much needed for the society's progress. And also, he highlighted on how there should be synergy in curriculum from KG to PG. And then we had the founder secretary of Disha Bharat, Srimati Rekha Ramachandran, who gave an outlay of what are all the main policies, points that we have in the new education policy, in the national education policy, which are already implemented from this 15-year-old organization. And to move on, our program will cannot be ended, and my word of thanks of address can never be ended without me thanking the vice chancellors of various deemed and esteemed institutions, management heads, principals, department heads, senior faculties, professors, lecturers, and all participants and viewers who are logged in onto this webinar link and are also actively watching and participating live from the Facebook page of Disha Bharat. So a humble thanks and a heartfelt thanks to all of you for your active participation. And looking forward to working with you all more and more, as all our efforts can only be contributing more for a purposeful progress of this society in large. But with education only, this can happen. And I get reminded of DVG's Mankutimana Kagga. And before even moving to that, I would again like to thank the three partners for contributing and supporting this program of ours: Government of Karnataka, Youth for Seva, and AICTE. DVG avaru ond kade heltare, ನೂತ್ನತೆಯ ಪೂರ್ಣತೆಯ ನನ್ಯೂನತೆಯ ಗಳಿಪ ಯತ್ನಮೇ ಪೌರುಷ ಪ್ರಗತಿ ಅದೇ ಪ್ರಕೃತಿ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಕಲೆ ಕಾವ್ಯ ವಿದ್ಯೆಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ಧನ್ಯತೆಯ ಬೆದಕಾಟ ಮಂಕುತಿಮ್ಮ. So all of us want only this, what Swami Vivekananda says. We want that education by which character is formed, strength of mind is increased, intellect is expanded, and by which one can stand on his own feet confidently, skillfully, and with lot of values is what Disha Bharat is trying to do. So let us all grow together and discover this higher purpose of life and contribute to the best of our ability to this progress of our nation. Thank you very much.
Dhanyavad, everybody. Thank you.